Thank you, Lord. Go ahead and play that next one, brother. See, she called me old friend this morning, Pastor Jerry. I've been bringing some of these old songs out. Thanks. Play that old song, track 14. Hallelujah. Somebody say, the Most High. Go to try. There ain't no high like the Most High. Listen to this song. I don't need swinging doors, a jukebox or a bar stool. I don't need a long neck, long star to get me high. I don't need no happy hour, cause all my hours are happy since I met Jesus. Have control of my life.
So
Somebody say, amen. Praise God. What? Why in the world would you want to start a new year that way? Come on, think about it. People do that and they call it having fun. Hanging out in the Oval Office. Come on. At John's ministry. Praise God. Hanging out over the porcelain throne. Upchucking everything inside. Because they got so drunk the night before they can't even remember nothing. Amen? Hallelujah. That's no way to start a new year. But there is a new wine. There is a divine drunk that I want to advocate here tonight. I'm not advocating by any means getting drunk, amen, glory to God, with that lowercase spirits that you see on, amen, those advertising and on the side of the buildings where they sell alcohol and liquor and beer and whatever. Praise God. But I'm talking about capital spirit, Holy Spirit. Ephesians 5:18 said, be ye not drunk with wine wherein is excess. Somebody say it's a waste. That's why they call it getting wasted. You know, I ain't never met nobody that said, boy, I got wasted last night and tomorrow, and today my marriage got all bent. Anybody read? Amen. Praise God. God said it's a waste, but then he goes on and metaphorically, not that he's comparing so much as he is using some contrast in the spirit. Amen. The Ephesian writer Paul here goes on and says, but be ye filled with the Spirit. So likewise, there's some similarities. There's a connection somewhere there. So before I go ahead and preach this, I got to already defend, amen, what I'm about to preach. Because some people would get offended, amen, praise God, because they ain't got ears to hear what the Holy Ghost said half time anyhow.
Come on.
They throw words all in your mouth. Oh, you hear what he said? I've preached on sin. I'm talking about specific sins. You know, preachers still do that. Because the Holy Ghost still does that. And I mean, I preach on sin, and I've had people get mad, leave, boy. And so I don't feel like I've successfully done something if I ain't made at least somebody mad. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah, man. And I've had people leave and say, well, he called my name while he was talking about it. I said, go back and tell them I didn't even know who they was. I didn't even know their name, but I don't doubt their name was called. Holy Ghost called their name. And I said, well, you tell them thank you, because in my voice and the Holy Ghost sound like the same. Praise God. Amen. Praise God. What a compliment. But I didn't say their name, but God did say their name. He spoke to them. He called their name, whatever it was, said, that's you. You need to repent. Praise God. So, but I want to build on this stage, amen, about being drunk in the Spirit. Somebody say, new mind for a new year. And I want to go to Acts chapter 2 in just a few moments. Praise God. Amen. But before we do, I got to just go ahead and deal with where we're going, because Proverbs 20 verse 1 says, wine is a mocker and strong drink is raging, and whoever's deceived thereby is not wise. Ain't it amazing that the devil puts on a dark bottle and on a can Budweiser? And God's word says, hey, bud, you need to wise up. You ain't too wise. You're deceived, matter of fact, if you drink this stuff. Brother, I don't see nothing wrong with an occasional little toddy for the body, a little social drink, a little social sin. Let me tell you, every drunk was a social drinker to begin with.
Yeah, that's right.
I don't know no drunk, if you really ask them and they're honest, did you like that when you drank it? No, I had to develop a taste for it.
Come on.
Yeah. Everybody breathe.
Yeah.
Every drunk started off as a social drinker. Somebody say drinking. Now let's get clarified here. Okay, somebody's out, you don't go too high. I ain't talking about drinking Kool-Aid. I ain't talking about drinking water. I ain't talking about drinking milk. Come on, somebody. Amen. Look at your neighbor and say, he ain't talking about got milk. Praise God. I'm talking about alcoholic beverages.
Come on.
Come on. And I got to prove something to you before I go any further, or you might mistake what I'm preaching about now. That's for those that can't hardly hear. I don't think nobody's here like that, but somebody may be watching, and we have thousands of watch around the world on the internet. So just stay with us just for a moment. So everybody say with me, wine.
Wine.
Somebody say alcoholic beverage.
Alcoholic beverage.
Those who drink it are deceived.
Yeah.
Period.
Yeah. That's right.
That's Proverbs 20, verses 1. Well, can't you feel it? It feels good. I can feel somewhere, just a little slight somewhere, somebody might get a little mad.
Yeah.
It might be out in the internet world, but boy, I get turned on by it.
Yeah.
I get a natural, supernatural high when I know I'm speaking truth. Pastor Jerry, I know you do too. I can see it in your face. Praise God. It just turned me on.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. I'm getting high right now. Praise God. Because I can feel it. Somebody getting a little offended.
Yeah.
Praise God, getting right behind the devil. He's mad too.
Yeah.
Praise God. But hear this. You're deceived. I didn't write it. Proverbs 20, verse 1 said, I don't care if you go to church or not. You're deceived if you're drunk.
Yeah.
Right. Now, if we look, and I'm just going to turn there. I'm going to try to briefly get through this so I can preach, but I got to lay this foundation. Because I have preached on this in the past before and didn't do this. And I've literally watched people, I'm talking about saints, man. But was deaf. They couldn't hear what the Holy Ghost was saying the whole time. Just get out mad and walk out and start talking about it. You can preach about getting drunk, making fun about it. Yeah, you got them. Yeah. They didn't hear nothing I said. Amen. They was too busy being offended. But in Proverbs 23, verse 29, it said, who hath woes? Who hath sorrow? Who hath contentions? That means babblings and fightings. And who hath babblings? And who hath wounds without cause? Who hath redness of eyes? Oh, red eye.
Amen.
Visine can't help. Verse 30. They that tarry long at wine, they that go to seek mixed wine. Listen, he said, look not thou upon the wine when it is red, when it giveth his color to the cup. He's giving us a portrait here of it being fermented. When it moveth itself aright. Man, something wrong when you look in that cup and that stuff move. Then when they say, yeah, and there's an insect in some of them. If you drink stuff, an insect in it. Man, when they can take a lighter and light it and the stuff is on fire when you drink. And now we got drunk dummies. They had to invent cans that if you mash it a certain place, it'll turn a different color and let you know it's cold. Because they're so drunk dummy. Come on, somebody, they can't even, they, in the end of their fingertips, they can't even feel whether it's cold or not. It's talking about it's fermenting. He said it lasts. Somebody say it lasts. Now he's about to describe a hangover. At last, biteth like a serpent, stingeth like an adder. An adder is just another name for a snake. Well, they've got a sickness. Alcohol isn't a sickness, it's a devil.
Yeah, that's right.
It's a demon.
Yeah.
It's a snake.
Yeah.
It's that old serpent.
Ain't
no disease, it's a devil.
Yeah.
Call it what it is. Thine eyes, listen what happens when they get drunk. Thine eyes shall behold strange women. Sir, that means somebody ain't your wife. Hello? Come on, anybody breathe? Y'all still look at me, can't you? Man gets drunk, he wants to play around. Hello? Way to get killed, man. By your wife. He said in verse 29, who hath woes? And then he said right here, thine eyes shall behold woe man. Strange woe man. Somebody say, woe man! And thy heart shall utter. Listen, it's perverse things. Cursing. Drunk. Curse. Man, you didn't hear what you said last night? No, I didn't say all that. Yeah, dude, we got iPhones. Look here, you know. We recorded you.
Yeah.
Drunk people say stuff they would never say.
Yeah.
Come on. Verse 34, some of y'all laughing because y'all remember. They apart from the blood of Jesus. I've been delivered. Yea, thou shalt be as he that lieth down in the midst of the sea, or as he that lieth upon the top of the mast. In other words, he's talking about somebody seasick. He's talking about a hangover. They're sick now. That high has now become blue. The ecstasy has been now turned into listen, he said, they have stricken me, shalt thou say, and I was not sick. That's meaning before I got a hangover and I was drunk, people smiting me, hitting me. He said, they beat me, and I found it not. Now he's passed out. When shall I wake? I will seek it yet again. Somebody pull a Fred Sanford out and say, you big dummy. That's a dummy. You mean you're going to go back and drink something again? They got you that messed up.
Come on.
Come on, somebody.
Come on.
Think about it. He said they beat me up. I didn't feel a thing.
Yeah.
When you was drunk, you didn't feel a thing.
That's right.
But when that drunk's gone and you got a hangover, you feel it out. Yeah, it's magnified. That's right. And that's Proverbs 23, 29 to 35. So I just got to build the foundation here for one another. Isaiah chapter 5. See, y'all thought I just quote the Bible all the time. I actually have to read stuff too. Hallelujah. Somebody said, boy, you know all the Bible. I said, no, I don't. I've read it all, but I keep quoting it. Listen, Isaiah 5, verse 11. Woe! Woe means stop. Woe's a word for a mule. Look at your neighbor and say, thou shalt not be a mule. And the church said, hee-haw. Come on, we've had enough of them in Washington, D.C. We don't need no more here now. Come on, their emblems even that of one. Amen. Wow! Stop! Wow! Unto them that rise up early in the morning, that they may follow strong drink and continue until night, till wine inflames them. Talk about somebody getting drunk. And the harp and the vial and the tabard and the pipe and the wine are in the feast. Boy, they partying hard. But they regard not the work of the Lord. Boy, they partying, son, getting drunk. But God says what happens, it causes them not to regard the work of the Lord, neither consider the operation of his hand. You can't get drunk and party. Come on, and think somehow you're going to remember God and glorify God.
Come on.
Hello?
Come on.
Praise God. There's a generation that's partying. Amen. And I want you to know hell won't be a party.
Yes, God.
Metallica and AC/DC won't be in concert on the stage of hell. Air conditioners won't be turned on. And Jack Daniels won't be there. Come on, somebody. Anybody hear the Holy Ghost? Matter of fact, there won't even be no water there. Those that drink this, it's pretty clear. Galatians 5, amen, declares drunkards will not inherit the kingdom of God.
Amen.
Praise God. 1 Corinthians 6 says it likewise. And he goes on and he says, listen to this, verse 13, therefore my people are gone into captivity because they have no knowledge, and their honorable men are famished. He's still talking about those that's getting drunk, and their multitudes dried up. Listen to what it said, verse 14, therefore hell hath enlarged herself. Hell has enlarged herself without measure. She's opened her mouth without measure, and etc. You can go on and read it. But he's talking about those that getting drunk. That's how hell gets enlarged.
Yes.
Hell loves for people to be so deceived and think they can serve God and still just be a social sipper. Come on, somebody. She can drink and have a little tiny for about it. You know, well, they're having a party at the place of occupation, and just a little sick won't hurt. For didn't God say I can take a little bit of wine for the infirmities of my stomach? And the devil is a lie. Look at your neighbor. Tell them, say the grape juice do the same thing beneficially for you. Come on, somebody. If you got a drink, you can drink the non-alcoholic. Come on, somebody. You lie to yourself. You want to get a little buzz is all you want. And then condone it to suffice your own flesh. Everybody breathe. Breathe. Don't stop breathing on me. Don't worry about that. Praise God. So I've said all that to say this is that. I am no wise about to advocate getting drunk in the flesh. I'm totally against it altogether. And while we own this topic, before I get into the spiritual side of this, though it's all spiritual, but you know, understand what I'm saying. I'm not advocating getting drunk in the flesh. As a matter of fact, I'm just going to blow up one of these doctrines of demons right out of here. And all those little social drinkers and even some of these preachers that's compromised, and they'll sit and drink wine with the world and everybody else. And here's their defense. Well, Jesus turned water into wine. John 2, in the marriage of Cana of Galilee, he turned the water into wine. Yeah, but what kind of wine did he turn into? I'm glad you asked. In Leviticus chapter 10, verses 9, God spoke to Aaron, and he said to his sons after him, which were the Levitical priesthood, he said to them, you're not to drink strong drink. In Hebrews 10, verse 21, thank you, Holy Ghost, Jesus is called the high priest over the house of God. In Matthew 5:17, Jesus said, I have not come to destroy the law or the prophets, but I have come to fulfill the law. So my friend Jesus was accused by the Pharisees of being a wine bibber, a gluttonous man. Likewise, along with John the Baptist, he was called and said he was demon-possessed, and then he cast out devils by the chief of devils, the prince of devils, even Beelzebub. Come on. So the religious crowds in Jesus' day said he was a drunk, an overeater, and he was demon-possessed. When you start saying, well, Jesus turned water into wine, it's okay for me to drink it because Jesus turned water into wine, you have just joined the group of the Pharisees who accuses Jesus of being a drunkard. Look at your neighbor and say, Jesus weren't a bartender. That wasn't what was going on. The disciples weren't boozing brothers. Come on, anybody hear the Holy Ghost? That wasn't what happened in John chapter 2. Listen what the Holy Ghost is trying to teach us here tonight. And this may give you something to grab hold of, because, boy, you meet them in church everywhere. They get offensive, glory to God. I got to have a little wine cooler, because Jesus turned that water into wine coolers. You meant that? Glory to God. How in the world do you believe that trash? Come on. Jesus was a high priest. And when Jesus, we read, walking on the earth, this weren't under the new covenant. He was still walking under the old covenant. Come on, somebody. If he said, I've not come to destroy the law, but fulfill it. If Jesus drunk strong drink, if he drunk alcoholic wine, well, then the blood he shed on the cross would have been tainted with sin, because he would have broke the law. And if you break it in one area, you broke it all. Though he took our sins in his body on the tree, that we'd be in that of the sins to live in the righteousness, by whose stripes we were healed. 1 Peter 2:24. How can Jesus offer deliverance to the drunkard if he drank it himself? Hello? If you'll study concerning those days when Jesus walked the earth, in his culture that day, they considered it barbaric, literally. Because the wine or the grape harvest came just once a year. They considered it barbaric in this culture to drink even their fermented wine just straight. They diluted it with water. I mean, they watered it down.
Yeah.
Amen? Some of these preachers today would fit in right there. Praise God. That old brother water down. Hallelujah. But they would water it down, Pastor Jerry. It'd be 20 parts water, one part wine.
Yes.
That means you'd have to drink 20 glasses of their wine in that day just to start getting a little buzz. Our day, you drink about a glass or two, or however tolerant you are to alcohol. Come on, son, I'm just determined that. Praise the Lord God. But you wouldn't have to drink very much in our culture.
That's right.
To get wasted. It wouldn't take very long. Then that day, amen, glory to God. So they let it ferment for 60 days. Somebody say at least 60 days. It was aged, though they called it new wine. Well, in John chapter 2, when Jesus turned water into wine, the Bible said that the governor of the feast said, you've saved the best for the last. You've saved the good one for the last. In that culture, in that day, they referred to the good wine or the best wine not as the fermented wine, but as the fruit of the vine. The same thing Jesus drank with his disciples at the Last Supper, taking communion. communion. Come on, somebody. Honoring the Passover before he was crucified. And he said to them in Matthew 26 and 29, he said, fruit of this vine, I will not drink again until I drink it anew with you and my Father in his kingdom. In other words, Jesus didn't say, I'm going to drink new wine. He said, I'm just going to drink it anew. I'm not drinking the fruit of this vine until you drink it with me and my Father in heaven. When Jesus was talking about alcoholic wine, he was talking about his Father going to get drunk too when we all get to heaven. We're just all going to have a drunken party. That's all heaven going to be. Somebody say the fruit of the vine. The fruit of the vine was the fresh squeezed grape. It had been pressed. It had just been squeezed out. It was referred to as the good wine because the alcoholic kind tasted a little bad, but she endured the bad taste because of where it was going to take. Hello. So when the governor said, you've saved the best for last, he was talking about the fruit of the vine. They called it, they said wine. Hello. Now it was called mixed wine a lot of times, but a lot of times we read in the Bible, we just see the word wine and we think, wow, boy, they're getting drunk. Jesus wasn't no drunk. Jesus wasn't serving no wine coolers. Jesus weren't no bartender at the marriage of Cana of Galilee. Some of y'all looking at me like yard dog. Come on, somebody. How what you looking at me like that for? Some of you wondering, what if he said, what's that right? What that means. Hallelujah. Amen. Glory to God. You can't hear his voice in mine. My God, I'm giving you scripture. Hallelujah. I'm showing you that he was a high priest over the house of God. Hebrews 10:21. And according to Leviticus 10:9. He was not allowed to drink his own drink. And if he did, he can't save nobody.
That's right.
But he didn't. And he didn't serve.
That's right.
Jesus don't give alcohol to folks. He takes it from people.
That's right.
He don't deliver it to you. He delivers it from you. Praise God. If that made you mad, straighten up both your haymorns. Haymorns. Your halos on your horns. That's a new term right there. Don't look it up in the dictionary. Haymorns. Praise God.